Movie in history in the Godfather family.
As the movies were made, The Godfather became just kind of the biggest home movie in history.
Just a man that doesn't spend time with his family can never be a real man.
Gotta get up close like this. Bada-bing! You blow their brains all over your nice Ivy League suit.
You're my older brother, but don't ever take sides with anyone against the family again.
We're both part of the same hypocrisy. But never think it applies to my family.
Movies were very new to me, and Duval would say before each take, he said, no matter what you do, you're going to laugh on this take.
It's because I admire you and I love you that I kept things secret from you. Do you expect me to let you go? Do you expect me to let you take my children from me?
Godfather was textured or perfumed in a way by our memories of our Italian-American family.
Good when you played that you hadn't been let up for like 20 years. You had this responsibility and the old.
The thing that's different about Godfather 3 and Godfather 2 is that Michael is different. But in order to see how he's different, we got to get a few tastes of it. Because we need a little emotion. If we could put a little emotion like in three places in the movie, that would be the thing.
Because just have the weight of the gravity. That's what does it. And what I'm saying is that you've never, from the time you committed that first sin, you've never had the weight off of you. Okay? Well, and you must have. You can't take it anymore.
Okay.
It has to be different.
It seems to me that whatever the film lay in a balance, and if I kicked it one side and kicked it to be more personal and more even soap opera or more emotional, that would be enough to kick it over, you know?
But the audience has got to be like this. During this thing, you know, I mean, it's got to be Jesus. This guy is cracking. This guy is, for the first time, I know he's really worried that he did the wrong thing. I mean, he's got a conscience. I mean, how can we put the intensity of that in this moment alone? You see, there's no one in the room except this corpse. So he can speak freely, and I mean, you almost could see him by the coffin, being very emotional, and then he says. Where did I go wrong, is what he's saying. But, or did it, is it too late for me? Are my sins too great? Did I love too much or too little?
There's a point, like, you know, you get a virtuous man and he commits an unvirtuous act. He's so horrified that he's committed that unvirtuous act that becomes even more terrible, in a sense.
The only trouble is these are all intellectual ideas, yeah. And we're trying to get
a visual.
Something really just emotional that the guy's speaking from his heart. I mean, he's a guy who's clearly getting ready for death, and he's very worried that it's like King Lear, he hasn't set things right.
My history with The Godfather was very much the history of someone in trouble. I found the first movie very tough to do and very tough to finally pull off. I was a young director, I hadn't really done a lot of work, and I had this opportunity to do this novel. I thought of myself as a professional director making an adaptation of a novel. I knew that as the book became more popular and more successful, I realized that in a sense
It was beginning to outclass me in that I wouldn't have gotten the job had, you know, 5 months later the book become the sensation that it was. And even in the early weeks of the production, I knew that they were not happy with what I had done. The kind of classic style that I chose in rushes maybe didn't impress them. But I just wanted to survive it. I knew that my ideas regarding the casting were not popular. It had been a very difficult time to try to convince the studio that my notions about casting were right.
I remember he having a lot of he was having a lot of problems. Every time he mentioned Brando's name, one of the executives is the right word. Said, if you mention his name again, you're out.
And the guy who was then the president said, as president of Paramount Pictures, these are his exact words, as president of Paramount Pictures, Marlon Brando will never appear in this motion picture.
Let me lay it on the line for you and your boss, whoever he is. Johnny Fontaine will never get that movie.
I remember I just sort of fell on the floor and said to them, you know, at least give me a chance. They're all right. If, number one, he does the movie for nothing, if he does a screen test, and if he puts up a bond guaranteeing that he none of his shenanigans will cause a delay, you can consider him. So I said, all right. And I called up Brandon, whom I didn't know, and, you know, had made that contact and said, oh, what if I do some makeup tests, I said, you know, to get around the screen test. And I went and I brought Italian cheese and cigars and stuff. And we were just shooting and shooting, and he saw the cheese and went like that, and he started to like take his hair and put shoe polish on. And he says, he's like a bulldog, and puts on his hand. He says, I want to have, you know. And he's doing this right there, and I'm shooting it, and then like he started going, he put Kleenex in his mouth, and he had black. It's remarkable to see.
Buonasera. Buonasera. What have I ever done to make you treat me so disrespectfully? If he'd come to me in friendship, then the scum that ruined your daughter would be suffering this very day. And if by chance an honest man like yourself should make enemies, then he would become my enemies. And then they would fear you.
Be my friend? Godfather?
In, I forget the amount of time, but a very short time, he knew the cast. As a matter of fact, Bobby Duvall, Al Pacino, and myself flew up to San Francisco, the Zoetrope. Eleanor, his wife, cut our hair, put a bowl over her head, cut our head, and with a 16-millimeter camera, you know, we improvised and did some stuff. And that was it, okay?
Don, Don Corleone, please.
Hey, it's good, huh? It's good.
That cost him like four corned beef sandwiches, I think, the whole, you know.
I was more or less just sort of wandering. I didn't know what was going on. I mean, movies were very new to me, and Duvall would say before each take, he said, no matter what you do, you're going to laugh on this take. And I didn't want to laugh.
I want to hear this, Sonny, but if your father dies, make the deal.
It's easy for you to say he's not your father. Wait a minute, it's easy for you to say it's not your father. It's easy for you to say it ain't your father. F*** you and your
Very nice, Jim.
Thank you.
Awesome.
Come on, you asshole.
You started it.
I know you don't want to hear it, Sonny, but if your father dies, make the deal.
Well, it's easy for you to say he's not your father.
When I read The Godfather, whenever I would see the character of Michael...
Two.
I saw Al's face.
Luca Brasi held a revolver against Hallie's head, and my father told Hallie that either his signature or his brains would be on the contract.
He wasn't a star. Which was not pleasing to the executives at that time. He didn't look like stars look like at that time in the business.
So that when they were suggesting, you know, like Ryan O'Neill or Robert Redford could be like a Northern Italian, I already had Al's face ingrained.
Michael, why are all these people bothering your father on a day like this?
Oh, that's because they know that no Sicilian can refuse any request on his daughter's wedding day.
Oh, good. I have a request.
For some reason, they were...
Well, you have to wait online.
Not happy with Al's test. Mm-hmm. But I knew Francis wanted Al.
And 104. Action.
I was aware that they didn't want me, and
it seemed okay
finally. I thought, Francis, look, I mean, we'll do another movie together. I was relatively young, so I didn't know quite. I thought, well, maybe they were all like this. You know, they get all. I had seen movies about Hollywood. I thought maybe that's why all the screen tests.
Well, this is a slow wedding. This isn't a wedding.
One night I got a call from Francis. He was in New York, and he said, Jimmy, and I could tell from his voice this was not his idea. Jimmy, why don't you come in and test? I said, test what? What, do you got a Porsche you want me to drive around the block? What do you want? Test what? He said, please, they want you to play Michael. Why? Please, so I went in.
168.
Michael, why are all those people bothering your father on a day like this?
Oh. Well, that's because they know no Sicilian can refuse a request on his daughter's wedding day.
Oh, good.
I don't think you can name an actor that wasn't there. They were all sitting around on cement floors from 7 in the morning to late at night. Guys with, some guys talk like this, you know. I mean, that guy's from all over the world.
They tried to kill him, my father. They did. They nearly did. Mr. Brazzi went after them. And so the story goes.
The story goes that he killed 6 men in 2 weeks. He killed 6 men in 2 weeks. 6 men in 1 week.
And he kept sneaking Al in, you know? At the end of the day, he kept testing Al, you know?
It kept happening a lot. And it was countless. They went on and on. I remember saying at the time, you know, I just don't respond well to being around where I'm not wanted. I would rather, you know, it's tough enough, an actor, you know, rejection. Well, anyway, he just stayed with it. It was his tenacity, and that got me in there.
Luca Brazzi held a gun to his head, and my father assured him that either his brains or his signature would be on the contract. That's a true story.
A little point of memorabilia, that was Marsha Lucas, who was the editor, George's wife, who cut those tests all together.
Remember John Marshall?
And she told me that, she said, cast Al Pacino because he undresses you with his eyes.
Marsha said
that.
Yeah. She was right.
And Diane said, I said to Diane, which one do you want? She said, Al.
I knew Diane before the test. We had a kind of immediate like for each other. And Francis, I think, recognized that and thought that that would be useful in the picture.
You're trying to scare me. You don't want me to marry you. That's very clever, but it's not going to work.
Okay. I saw her in a movie called Lovers and Other Strangers, and two things. I just thought she was I just liked her myself. I thought she was a cute woman, you know. I just was attracted to her. But also because she was so eccentric and kind of weird in a way, her delivery, that I thought this character of Kay could be like really straight, boring character, and that maybe Diane would bring some eccentricity to it.
Fredo, my brother Fredo, this is Kay Adams.
Hi.
How are you doing?
So what I'm saying is that they spent $400,000 or so on tests and wound up with the 4 corned beef sandwiches.
I was already hired as Michael. They kept saying, well, when is he going to do something? while we were shooting, there were hints coming back to me that I wasn't wanted. And with more than hints, people were actually, you know, giggling when I'd go on camera. And the studio kept seeing this footage coming back, and they said, well, he seems dull. I was out, and then the Sollozzo scene came.
Ti senti meglio?
What guarantees can I give you, Mike? I am the hunted one. I missed my chance. You think too much of me, kid. I'm not that clever. All I want is a truce.
They kept me after that scene. That looked pretty good, I guess, when you could shoot a guy. They wanted me to assert myself, so there, what, you know, there's that kind of assertion.
How long do you think it'll be before I can come back?
At least a year, Mike. Listen, I square with Mom, you know, you're not seeing her before you leave, and I'll get a message to that girlfriend when I think the time is right.
But De Niro tried out for the part of Sonny. And he did. We shot a test on De Niro, which I think exists, that was so electrifying.
I think I did. Did I do the screen test for Sonny? Yeah. Me and 4,000 other people or whatever, we all came in.
You're going to take both of them out on me. You're going to take them. And you know what they're going to do to you? And you know what you do when you knock somebody off? You take a gun, you shoot them right up against his head. That's what you do. You get his brains all over your nice new Ivy League suit, Michael. That's what happens. How do you like that?
It was spectacular, but it was Sonny really like killer, you know, like nothing you could ever sell.
I know you can do it. All right, you prove it to me. You can do it. Go ahead, prove it.
Hey, what are you gonna do? Nice college boy, huh? Didn't want to get mixed up in the family business? Huh? Now you want to gun down a police captain? Why, because he slapped you in the face a little bit? Huh? What do you think, this is the army where you shoot him a mile away? You got to get up close like this, and bada-bing, you blow their brains all over your nice Ivy League suit. Come here.
But I never forgot that, you know, and later on when we were stumped on how to do the young Marlon, I thought that he could be the young Brando. I went to Paramount, I told them the idea, they said no.
No. One thing we were trying in Sicily when I was older, Brando had some thing in his mouth, and I went to the same dentist and just got a smaller one. And I tried to, like, get a little heavier for that period because he was a little older and a little, you know, a little mature and so on. And so one of the things we were trying to decide was about the mustache, whether I should have a mustache or not. And it was a whole thing back and forth to make this commitment to have the mustache or not to have the mustache. So finally, I said, you forget these things, but I think the way I remember it is, I said, well, why don't we flip a coin? And just flip the coin, and heads it's on, tails it's off, and so it was heads, I guess.
I think when Francis and Mario get together and start talking about this subject, anywhere near it and around it, it's still in them, and there's something that stimulates them about it. And, you know, Francis is a good example of that saying, man's reach should exceed his grasp, or what's a heaven for? I'd heard about three throughout these years, but Francis saying he was going to do it. But Francis is funny that way, you know. He'll give you little hints about things, and he'll give you a little hint, and he throws it out. And he says, you know, I don't know, maybe I'm going to do this, but Well, they want me to do this, you know, and then you say, he's planning something. That's a couple of years before it happens, too.
You want C, take four, A and B cameras. Have a party, folks! And background!
They have a lot of fun.
This last film is more than a number after a title. It's not Godfather 3. It's the continuing saga of this Corleone family, of this march through life that Francis is investigating.
You know, Michael, now that you're so respectable, I think you're more dangerous than you ever were. In fact, I preferred you when you were just a common mafia hood.
Okay. Now, can we talk common sense here?
All right.
Okay.
Tony knows that you killed Fredo.
Michael's always been the kind of a character to me that made a choice early on when he said he was going to go with his father to protect his father. And from that point on has, paid for it.
I spent my life protecting my family!
Let's be reasonable, okay? That's your big thing, isn't it, Michael? Reason? Backed up by murder?
Oh, God. Don't you hate me? You hate me?
No, I don't hate you. I dread you.
I did what I could, Kay, to protect all of you from the horrors of this world.
But you became my whore.
I've always felt Michael had a kind of a disdain for gangsterism. He's looking for a kind of a face so that he can turn everything back. He wants to turn it back the way it was before it all started. You know, it's always before he got into this kind of trouble. I mean, he bit, you know what I mean? He bit, and it's a lifetime. It's really, can you go back again?
Just when I thought I was out, they pulled me back in.
There's a lot of fear in Michael. I think somewhere he understands now by three.
Our true enemy has not yet shown his face.
Three now is about how to sort of cope with all that's happened and pave the way for the third generation.
Michael, this is Vincent Mancini, Sonny's boy.
How you doing, Mr. Corleone?
How you doing?
I'm doing good. How you doing? Good party.
Oh, you like it?
Yeah, I had to sneak in.
Well, you're dressed for it.
I don't think Francis knew who I was. He says that he says Paramount was suggesting some kid, you know, the Paramount suggestion, you know.
Mark.
Who do they want now, you know, for the part? Because apparently he had some wild suggestions from before, you know, and who was going to play Michael Corleone, so.
Remember Vincent who was this guy? Mancini?
Is he Spanish? Who do they? Yeah.
What's the trouble between you and Mr. Joseph?
Just trouble. I'll take care of it.
It's foolish of you.
Foolish of me? Things a little foolish of this guy, don't you think? Right?
Vincent.
Right!
Temper like his father.
When I finally Vincent. Did Godfather 2, I tried to end it. And then I felt, well, it's over, basta. And went on my way. And then I kept hearing, oh, they want to make another Godfather. I said, well, that's fine to want to make it. But, you know, about what? I pretty much mined the emotional material of that family. And it's not like other kinds of sequels where you just then, like Sherlock Holmes, drum up another adventure.
Francis never said no to me, which encouraged me, because I always kind of thought that there is going to be a moment in time when he is going to want to do it.
I said the only Godfather film I would do after this is, you know, Abbott and Costello meets the Godfather, you know, and you have the Abbott and Costello and, hey, Abbott, the guy is over, you know.
We talked to actors like John Travolta, Sly Stallone. I mean, it took all kinds of permutations.
Then, of course, they were all thinking, well, Michael would have a son, and he would go on, and et cetera, et cetera.
It became a Las Vegas story, became an Atlantic City story in the casinos there.
But for me, the tragedy of The Godfather, which is the tragedy of America, is about Michael Corleone. By the end of Godfather II, just like America in that period, Michael had become wrapped in kind of self-righteousness and distrusted everyone and
getting more and more like a you know, paranoid person, like a Nixon.
There's no doubt that there's a thug sort of lurking somewhere in Michael, but something that he doesn't really cater to or admit to. And even if he does admit to it at times, it's not something he's comfortable with.
Don't ever again give that kind of order. Not while I'm alive. I command this family, right or wrong. It was not what I wanted!
There was always some little weird detail before the violence happens. Remember, like in Godfather 2, when the light bulb is out and the towel catches fire, or some little thing that causes you to remember, even though it may be very, very short.
Got the idea from someone who told me about how they had heard this is how people in that situation would wrap a towel around a pistol and do this kind of slaying execution or whatever.
I remember in Rome one day there was some Italian holiday and they said, well, this Monday is closed. I said, closed? You know, we got our whole people here, we got a lot of work to do. So we invented cafe production. We just went to the Via Veneto and we got set up on around, you know, this big long table and we just did our day's work sitting in a cafe. And I remember in that session, we were going through everything and we had the idea, well, what if in the middle of this big kind of summit meeting in Atlantic City and all of a sudden all the table started shaking and everyone thought it was like an earthquake. And then I thought, well, it'll be interesting if just while they're sitting there, you know, little glasses are shaking and the spoons are tinkling, you know, and then you go and you reinvent everything. We were always changing the scenes, so you had to remain very loose to, you know, come up with whatever you could.
Everything was always, you know, up for grabs, you know. It was only, the only thing that was sacred was what, in fact, was in the can. And if it wasn't in the can, it could change the next day. I mean, I think Dean Tavolari said that with Francis, the script is like a newspaper and a new one comes out every day.
Well, one of the things he does that's so brilliant, several, 2 months before we started this film, he brought the cast to Napa Valley, to his home.
Now, I'm interrupting you. Like, we would like to rewrite the scene.
And to his little studio on the outskirts of San Francisco. And we sat around, we read the script, we talked, and he's brilliant at it, brilliant.
No, I understand, but it still is the end. I mean, you
want
to
But we
gotta
do that step first before we
can
do that.
We're gonna have 4 hours of emotion, but it's going to all happen in 4 minutes because I have many things to resolve. I have you, I have you, I have the other one, I have the other one, and it all has to be like one great emotional thing.
Okay? Yeah, but it's like, how does it end? How does it end?
But they all work out at the end. That
early on in Napa, we were just going through readings. Francis had kind of conceived Vincent as a combination of all the brothers and the grandfather. He had kind of the temper. Sonny
and then they will fear you.
The smarts of Vito. The calculations of Michael. And the warmth of Fredo.
He's hired a professional assassin to kill you. He's Sicilian. I don't know his name. But they say he never fails.
Then no one is safe.
This is a conspiracy, and it's got to have the feeling of a conspiracy being unraveled, and bam, the solution is made, and you guys are going to fight back.
You arrange a meeting.
You say how devoted you are to me. You tell him your problems. You ask for his help.
What problems?
That you want to run away with my daughter. Only you know that if you do, I will become your enemy.
With Francis, when he gets set up in something, he's always going to go, and he's going to reach, and he's going to go try to go further than he did before. I knew when he said he was going to do it, when he first said it, it was 2 years before he said he was going to do it, because I think he had to ruminate about it. And then finally, when it did come, he had, I think, something he wanted to talk about.
Now I want to do two or three scenes that are breakthrough scenes, but I need to have the scene be like where people get a little nervous.
Maybe he kind of sobs a little bit at that moment. And then he just looks out of his emotion. He says, Pop. Pop. What would you do now? We had the same dream. Pop. What would you do now? I mean, he reaches out to his father. I mean, what could his father give him at this point? What wisdom is he looking for?
This wasn't enough time, Michael. Wasn't enough time.
We'll get there, Pop. We'll get there.
Maybe the guy thought he loved his family so much, but maybe he was always a loner, and that's why he couldn't really, you know, he became too much the head of the family in his mind and not enough in his heart. You know, a real father, a real family member always does what's good for the family. See ya. Taking your picture.
I always really treasured the times with the family and loved all of them very much. I always thought that those get-togethers with my uncles and my cousins always were high points to me. And I learned to turn to them when I was in trouble, and I reached out wherever I could to, for those things that I knew were definite because I had lived that way. And as the movies were made one after another, more and more, The Godfather became just kind of the biggest home movie in history. And my attitude was, well, if I'm gonna get fired, why not have Tally play the part, because maybe it'll be good for her.
So you know what I did the first day when I went on the set the first day? I walked into the camera. I knocked it down, and because I didn't wear my glasses, and I was so nervous. And Marlon Brando, I walked right smack. I mean, and he came over to see if I was okay because it was a very large. So naturally, the first day, the sister knocks the camera down.
Why not have my father get his break, so he can write the music? And why not put my little baby in the baptism scene? At least I'll have always a memory of that. It'll be like a home movie. I'll always be able to see what my kids looked like.
Well, I remember one time we were in New York, Little Italy, and we were sitting in the back of the old St. Patrick's Cathedral in Little Italy, where we were shooting some of the scenes. And he just happened to lean over to me, and I remember him saying, he says, you know, this is the church where we shot the baptism in part one. And I looked around, I says, oh, wow. You know, and I got kind of a little chill. I thought, this is great. Oh, this is that same church. I didn't know that. And he says, yeah, I see. See up on the altar there, the baptismal font? I says, yeah, oh, that's fantastic. That's right. Oh, that's where they baptize a little baby. Then he says, now you see my daughter Sophia over there standing next to the baptismal font, which she was, you know. So I look over at Sophia, who's about 19 years old now. As I'm looking at her, he says to me, she was the baby. And it was like, whoa, it gave me that little, you know, that made the hair stand up on my neck for a second.
Diane Keaton looked to me like she really hadn't held a child before, because I kept seeing Sophia's head sort of falling off her arm, and it was all I could do to keep from running up there and sort of propping her head up.
I'm your little cousin.
When my dad was writing the script, you know, he naturally based it on, when he's writing about a daughter, he based some of it on me.
Who's your father?
I'll give you a hint. He's Italian.
At the beginning, I remember going to Diane Keaton and saying, like, oh, my God, I have to do this kissing scene with Anne in front of my dad, blah, blah, blah. And she said, like, and I was, like, really scared to do it. I just did not want to do it. And she said, oh, no, they're fun. They're really fun to do, like, love scenes. Because you get to, like, do all the things you're not supposed to do, which you can't really do. So then it was fun.
Cut. Very nice. So everyone look toward me, nice and beautiful smile, the Corleone family. All right, here's one. Take a picture, and now one more. Everyone look. And Vincent, try to smile, will you, Vincent? And go.
Well, it does seem like he draws a lot from his personal life, family experience. And then, of course, people tell me that there's something related to Kay and myself. It's the WASP wife, who is not Italian, not really a member of the family, it's always a little on the outside, excluded. Diane recently said to me that, yes, she was modeling the role on me, and I'm always a little startled to think that there's that much similarity.
It is natural to feel like a band of actors or a band of a family. You know, it occurs besides, of course, Francis additionally trying to have people come together with dinners and rehearsal periods, which are really nothing more than creating kinfolk out of each other.
And my idea is that when a cast early on can do something sort of sensual together, eat together or in some way really participate together, that they get certain kind of bias that stays with them. And then much later, when you're in a scene and something happens, that comes out and accounts for the kind of realistic response, because the preparation has, you know, prepared them for it.
You know what's so interesting about this movie too, at least to me, I found this kind of mind-crushing deja vu, because we take this whole group of people, and then you're all standing there looking at each other on a location, dealing with a place and dealing with actors you dealt with 20 years earlier, you know, and it's staggering, and you rarely get an opportunity ever, not rarely, you don't get an opportunity ever to do a thing like that.
When you bring back the whole crew from the previous pictures and you're using old collaborators who knew each other over many years, who had gotten old together, who had learned together, has to have some flavor that will influence the theme, because it is about a family being made by a family.
I said to Ellie years ago, and it's very true, I said, we're the Voilanders. We're the most dangerous act in town. But you know, something about a circus family is that you can do the difficult stunts with your own family. Whatever goes on, which is supposed to in the development and in the rivalries and the joys and the memories, if it's a family member and you're doing a triple, they'll catch you.
I remember one scene which shows the level of our mentality. We had to do a scene in which the Godfather was supposed to die. And we had a break for lunch, and there was like about an hour left. We put up two cameras that time, and we just said, well, this little kid didn't want to play with Marlon, didn't want to do the scene, and if we didn't get it, and we broke for lunch, that would be the end of the light, and we would never get it. So Marlon had an idea. He said, look, let me show you this. And he took the orange peel, put it in his mouth, and I said, let's just roll, because we've got to go to lunch. He's mad because we're losing the light. He said, let's just do it. So we rolled with two cameras, and sure enough, Marlon put the orange peel. And if you see the shots, you see how there's an accident. The kid reacted and ran around. And so sometimes you catch lightning in a bottle. I mean, that's what you hope to do.
I love you.
It's like fundamental in the story, if Michael really could talk to his father, let's say Michael went to heaven, And there he was greeted by Don Vito Corleone. And he says, Pop, Pop, I'm here. How did I do? And the father says, you forgot one thing. And he says, what? He said, whatever I did, I always listened to my heart. And Michael said, I did too. Let him stay in the mood. Let's go. Just like that, standing by the roll. Don Tomasino, we won all our battles, you and I. And to what purpose? My family still is in danger. You in your coffin. Only 90, you could have lived a little longer. And I could be nearer to my dreams.
You could have lived longer. I could be closer to my dreams.
Like after Sonny died, kind of that weakness being wounded.
Because it's like pain to it.
It's so interesting. Francis just can give you a narrative. I mean, he can stand there all day and tell you what the characters are thinking. This is so unusual. There may be more Michael and Francis there are than me.
How did your virtues become my sins?
What was it?
Why was I feared while you were loved?
I was no less honorable.
I wanted to do good.
I tried to do good. What betrayed me?
What betrayed me? My mind?
My heart.
Or was it my heart? I swear on the lives of my children, give me this one last chance to redeem myself. And I will sin no more.
No more.
That kiss is like a guitar string. Like that, it had a 1-2, but if it could just, you know, have the one.
Okay. Want to get out of that heavy thing again. That's good.
Evolution. The film crew itself is a family that goes through three generations. The story is going through three generations. In life, if you put yourself in harmony with the natural way of things, you get a much better result than if you try to go against that.
Well, in 3/4 of an hour, you can see Al Pacino continuing his hard-won but electrifying portrayal of Michael, now the Don and ruthless head of a business empire with corrupt dealings in Las Vegas and Havana. Robert De Niro co-stars in the accompanying turn-of-the-century flashback story of young Vito Corleone, begetter of the entire troubled clan. Godfather 2 at 10 o'clock.